Jesus. having a seat. That might be the most responsible timing I've done yet. Hey, welcome to Three Rivers Church. If you're visiting with us this morning, and church members, it is so good to see you. I saw you already visiting with each other, but this time we set aside just to say welcome, and we're glad that you're here. And man, we're even more thankful that you're here because we're in the midst of whatever this year 2020 is. What a mess it has been. But we are thankful that in the middle of the mess, we've got the freedom to come together and worship in freedom. So we're going to squeeze everything out of that we can. If you're visiting with us, there's a communication card that you can find on the back of the pews. And if you're a member and you've got changes that you need to let us know about, whether it be address or phone number or email address, or if you've got a promotion you're trying to brag about, I don't know. If you want to do that, you can. But those will be placed in the offering plates, not the offering bowls or buckets, but the offering plates in the very back corner. And we also have a drop box or a little slot in the side of the wall that you can put that in as well. So we're just excited that you're here. And we are in the middle of worshiping. And man, what some upbeat songs we had. Worshiping. And we worship through the giving of our tithes and offering too, because we know as a follower of Christ that Jesus Christ gave everything. He gave us all. He held nothing back. What love is that? And our natural response to that kind of love is to say, you have my life, whatever you want. That includes my time, my talents, my resources, my money, whatever you need from me, Lord, it's yours. You gave everything, I give everything. Well, we say that with words very easily, don't we? But putting that into action, Pastor Ian reminds us always weekly that we need to be doers of the word, not just hearers of the word. Amen? So, sometimes we come in here, and I will remind you, what brings us together is worshiping Christ. What connects us together is the blood of Christ. What makes us in fellowship is our faith in Jesus Christ. And we are currently all at some place in our life. So, sitting right here, I have some people that it couldn't get any better. Everything's going great in your life. And I've got some people sitting out here, you're desperately holding on. And you're barely putting it together. Barely got here to church today. And we got everything in between. Some of us have experienced great gains. Some of us have experienced losses. Some of us got fantastic news this week. Some of us got terrible news. And I just want to remind you that our hope is not on our circumstances. Our hope is not on our feelings. Our hope is not in the actions of family members, loved ones. Our hope is not in our paycheck or our career. Our hope's not in our political leader or the confusion of who that may be. Our hope is not in a country that will serve its time and go away, as nations have come and gone. But our hope is in Jesus Christ.
That's right.
In his kingdom, there is no end.
That's right.
It stands forever.
Thank you, Lord.
Don't forget that. It's easy to forget that because we're in a lost world. And just full of hate and bitterness and disdain and opposing the things of Christ. Don't be caught off guard by that. That's normal. But that's why we're in the dark world. We are called to be light. So don't let the darkness tarnish you.
Amen.
Don't let it discourage you. There ain't nothing like darkness to make a little light shine bright. Right? And if you got to go old school and start singing "This Little Light of Mine," so be it. But let our aim and our goal in these dark times be to be the light. There's never a time when I see a full moon that I'm not just don't pause and go, man. And I look in the backyard and everything glows when normally I can't see a thing. But that light's not coming from the moon. That light's coming from the sun. And as the moon reflects the light of the sun, so we reflect in this clay dust body the light of the Son of God, Jesus Christ. Amen? Feeling encouraged? That's because we remind ourselves of what our hope is put in. Amen. Father, we come before you, Lord. I thank you for the freedom we have today to worship you. Lord, let us not squander that. Lord, I thank you for the breath that we have in our lungs. Lord, as we exhale that breath, we have the ability to make a joyful noise, to sing praises to you, to glorify you. Father, help us to grow in you today. Help us to be nourished by your word today. Help us to reflect on the teaching of Jesus Christ today and hold ourselves accountable to your scripture, Lord. You set the standard. Your word is the standard we live by. Not our feelings, not our own moral compass, your word. Lord, change us and mold us and make us. Help us to pursue righteousness and to flee from evil. And Lord, give us all the equipping we need to go out and be a reflection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the light of the world, the hope of all mankind. Lord, the message that was delivered so long ago, a Savior was born, and a Savior died, and he was resurrected. And we put our hope in the resurrected Christ.
Yes.
He is our Lord and our Savior. He is our everything. It is Jesus who we worship. It's in his name we pray. Amen.
And as we get ready to move into this next song, and just circling back and touching back on what Mark was just saying, I do want to remind you that no matter where we are in this life, no matter what we may face, no matter what tomorrow holds, if you're in Christ, we rest in him. We're found in his arms. We're found in his love. That's where we rest. And in that, we can find great confidence. Would you stand and sing this with us?
Without you, my world slips away.
redeemed by your mercy, consumed by your grace. Now I live for you. Oh, I'm found in the arms of love. Your love, it has saved my soul. And I'll run to your arms of love. Your life's gonna lead me home. And I'm found in the arms of love. Your love, it has saved my soul.
At your cross, I lay my burdens at your feet, where your love covers all I've done. Now I walk with you, Lord. At your cross, I lay my burdens at your feet.
A promise of things yet to come. There is a one born for our salvation, Jesus. There is a light that overwhelms the darkness. There is a kingdom that forever reigns. There is a freedom from the chains that bind us. Jesus, Jesus. Who walks on the waters, who speaks to the sea, who stands in the fire beside me.
There is a song that comforts in the night.
Song. That's why I thought we'd admit it. Ian told you last week that we are kicking off our Christmas series today. We got a 7-week-long Christmas series, and the theme of this series is Christmas through the carols. So for the next 7 weeks, we're going to touch on some of the classic Christmas carols that you would find in the hymn book. And they're in chronological order. They're spaced out so that we're kind of carrying you through the message of Christmas. And we're starting with the prophecies of there is a Messiah who would come. There's a long-awaited one who is promised by God. And so this morning, our message is, O come, Emmanuel. As we listen to the cries of the Hebrew people who had been in bondage for so many years, and they're looking forward to this Savior, this Redeemer who God had promised would come. And you can hear the cry of the people, O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel. And so this morning, that's our theme song. And so we're going to sing this, and then our brother John, he's going to come up here, and he's going to bring a message built around this song this morning. So would you sing this with us?
Rejoice, rejoice. Pastors were so gracious to let me preach this morning. Pastor Ian, especially helpful, asked if I needed a box to look over the pulpit. I said, that's okay, we'll be okay. Huh? Yeah, he's very helpful like that. So we're doing Christmas through the carols, as Pastor Zane has already said, and we're starting off with O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. And I'm one of those people who like Christmas carols after Thanksgiving. I'm one of those people, but some people like them early as possible, right? And there's a lot of good reasons. A lot of the Christmas carols, a lot of the Christmas songs are very bright and very cheerful, right? And we like that Christmas spirit, and we can just hear the jingle bells, and it gets us in the mood, right? And other songs, however, have a slightly different feel to them. They're a little bit more gloomy. You can almost feel like it's dark outside when you hear them. And I feel like O Come, Emmanuel is one of those songs. It's not quite as bright and cheerful. There's a little bit of sadness to it, perhaps, in how the chord arrangements are. And yet, it's not a song without hope. There's still a hopeful aspect to it. O Come, Emmanuel, it sounds this very slow tone to it, but rejoice, rejoice, he'll come to you, O Israel. So there's a gloomy aspect, but there's also a hopeful aspect. And I think that's really a good way to introduce the title to my message this morning. Now, some people, everyone learns differently. Some people like to take notes, and they like organization. So I'm giving you a title if you're one of those people. The title to the message is How to Hold It Together When Everything is Falling Apart. How to hold it together when everything is falling apart. Some of us, as Pastor Mark said a minute ago, this is the best day of your life. I mean, everything is just going great. Everything's great around you. Your world is not falling apart. However, others of us, as I say that, immediately something does pop into your mind because you are barely holding on. You're barely holding it together. This has been a rough year for a lot of people, hasn't it? Hasn't 2020 felt like everything's falling apart around us? And I'm not just talking politics. I'm not just talking on a macro level. A lot of us on a personal level. This has just been a struggle. So many of us are separated from our normal social interactions. So many of us are not able to do the things that we like to do. Some of us have gotten sick. Some of us have lost loved ones. And it feels like the world is falling apart around us. How do you hold it together when everything feels like it's falling apart? Even if we are feeling good this morning, we know what it's like to be in a place where it is just difficult, where we do not see how we're going to keep it together. We don't see how we're going to make it through the other side of this circumstance. And that's what Emmanuel is all about, I think we're going to see this morning. Just by way of introduction, this is the passage that we're all very familiar with when it comes to Emmanuel, this word. It's a very churchy word, isn't it? But it's not found in very many places in the Bible. It's surprising. It's only in two places in the Bible, and one of them we're really familiar with, and it's in chapter 1 of Matthew. We're not going to stay here too long, so it's going to be quick here. I only have 37 points to this message, so we're going to not be here very long. I'm just kidding. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Matthew had to put that little bit on the end there because a person who is of Greek, speaks a Greek language, would not know what Emmanuel means. That's not a Greek word. Does anyone know what the word transliteration mean? That's a big word. You didn't know you were going to school this morning. How about this? Here's an example. Chow mein. Has anyone ever used the word chow mein? Yeah. Okay, what does that mean in English? It's actually not an English word at all. It's a Chinese word that we chose not to translate into English. It means fried noodle. That's literally what it means if you were to translate it. Instead, we transliterated it, which means we just wrote it down in English as it sounds in Chinese. So chow mein means fried noodle. Same thing with this word Emmanuel right here. This is a Hebrew word, okay? Emmanu, with us, El God, God with us. A Hebrew speaker would know this. A Greek speaker would not. So Matthew, he has to put this on here, explaining it for the Greek reader who's coming to his book, who's not familiar with this prophecy, not familiar with this word, Emmanuel. He's introducing him, which means God with us. So he's including all of us non-Jewish people in this. He wants to make sure we understand. Now, to a Jewish person, though, however, they know very well what Matthew is alluding to. They know the Old Testament scriptures in a way that many of us can only dream of. They studied it from a very young age. It was pretty much the only thing they studied. They knew it backwards and forwards, inside and out. They knew exactly what reference Matthew is making here to Isaiah. They know this story. And I wonder if we know the story that this prophecy comes from. We know this one in Matthew. We know the story of Joseph and Mary and how it's the fulfillment of prophecy. But do we know the story that it comes from in Isaiah? Matthew, by putting this here, is inviting us to go back in time, take a look at where this prophecy came from. So we're going to do that. We're going to go to Isaiah 7. We're going to go to Isaiah 7. Where's the origin of this prophecy? Isaiah chapter 7. And while you're turning there, the first point to this message is going to be God is a God who speaks to us. God is a God who speaks to us. The story here is of a king named Ahaz. All right? And let's read the first couple verses here, and then we're going to take a long background study in what's going on here. Chapter 7 of Isaiah, it says, in the days of Ahaz, the son of Jotham, son of Uzziah, king of Judah, Rezin, the king of Syria, and Pekah, the son of Remaliah, the king of Israel, came up to Jerusalem to wage war against it, but could not yet mount an attack against it. When the house of David was told, Syria is in league with Ephraim, the heart of Ahaz and the heart of his people shook as the trees of the forest shake before the wind. It's really helpful that we've just been through Genesis, because there's a lot going on here. There's a lot of names and places, and it gets confusing to understand exactly who is interacting with who and where and all this stuff. It's helpful that we've just been through Genesis, because I'm going to draw on a lot of that, assuming that we've been paying attention through the past year or so through Genesis. What is going on here? So remember, Jacob had 12 sons, right? And these would become the 12 tribes of Israel. And through Genesis, they're in Egypt, right? And each one is blessed, and eventually we come to Exodus. They leave Egypt. Now they're a big people. They went over 70 people. Now they're a million. We don't know. There's a lot of people who leave Egypt and then take the promised land that God gives them. And God gives them different territories as they conquer it. Each tribe is assigned their own little spot. God has it all picked out for them, and they settle, and they create this nation. They have the land now of Canaan, and they settle it. And originally, there was no king in Israel, absolutely none. God was their king. As you read through the Mosaic Law, it is completely a theocracy. God is the king of Israel, and if they follow the law, there's going to be no problems. There's actually no need for another ruler there, because it's all spelled out on how the country is going to run, how it's going to be organized. As we see, time to time, they would slip into rebellion. God would give them what was called judges, and the judges would kind of take an authority role, a leadership role for a time being, get the country back on track, get them following God's laws again. It was a cyclical obey, and things were good, and then they'd start falling away, and they'd be punished, and a judge would rise up. Eventually, they come to the point where they say, you know what, we're tired of this system. We want a king. All the other nations around us have a king. We do not have a king, and we want to be like them. God actually grants them this request, even though he recognizes it's a rejection of him. Samuel's upset when they first ask for a king, and God said, Samuel, don't worry about it. They're not rejecting you. They're rejecting me. But he grants them their request for a king all the same. And it first comes to a man named Saul, who's from the tribe of Benjamin. He's a Benjaminite. Okay, so remember, 12 sons, each one tribe, people. He's from the tribe of Benjamin. Remember, he was the youngest son of Jacob, the youngest son of Rachel, the one that Jacob loved. Saul, though, he starts out okay as king, and eventually he starts making some mistakes, doing some things he should not do. And Samuel basically tells him, that's kind of a shame, Saul. If you had done what you were supposed to, God would have established your kingdom, but because you did not, he's tearing it away from you and giving it to somebody else. And he gives it to David. We know David well. We know the story of David, David and Goliath. He is from the tribe of Judah, a Judite. Okay, why is that significant? Well, we just saw a couple weeks ago, Pastor Mark preached that passage, I believe, where Jacob, when he's blessing his 12 sons, he says some very specific things about Judah. He says to Judah, your father's sons, that's a weird way to say brothers, your brothers, right? That's your father's sons. Your brothers shall bow before you, he says. And he also prophesies and says, the scepter shall not depart from Judah. So there is this prophecy already that Judah is going to be the kingly tribe. And we see that God gives it to David. He's from the tribe of Judah. And David, he does something different from Saul. He makes an unconditional covenant with him. There's lots of our phones are really helpful these days, aren't they? They always do exactly what you want them to do. There's lots of covenants in the Bible. There's lots of major ones. It's really important to, I feel like, if you're going to understand the narrative, the story of Scripture, understanding these covenants is really one of those key things that you've got to know. One of the biggest covenants that God that's in the Bible is this Davidic covenant, the covenant that God makes with David. And it's an unconditional covenant. There's two kinds of covenants. There's one where there's conditions in place. If this happens, then this happens. There's unconditional covenants as well, where there's no clauses, there's no asterisks, there's no fine print. It is an unconditional promise from God, and that's what God makes with David. The covenant is that there will forever be a son of David ruling on the throne. There wasn't a command for obedience if this happens, or if there was no ifs. It was, this is what I'm going to do, David. It's an unconditional thing that he gave to David and his family, that there would always be a descendant of David on the throne, that the Davidic line would not be replaced by some other family. Okay. Well, what happens in time? Eventually, the grandson of David makes some people angry, makes some bad decisions as a leader when he's king. The 10 tribes of Israel to the north broke off. Now, the two tribes in the south remained, Judah and Benjamin. They stayed together, and they're known from then on as the southern kingdom. The 10 tribes to the north, they go their own way. They set up their own capital city. They set up their own, or God gives them a king that they're going to be a separate nation. They're known as the northern kingdom. So the southern tribes, known as Judah, known as the southern kingdom, sometimes just called Jerusalem, but when you read that, it's referring to the whole kingdom, not just the city. And other times you'll read northern kingdom or Ephraim or Samaria. All of those are referring to the same thing, the northern tribes, the 10 tribes in the north. So what we see here, now it's all coming back to why I gave you all this context. It's talking about Rezin, the king of Syria. Okay, that's something separate. That's a different country altogether. Pekah, the son of Remaliah, king of Israel, came up to Jerusalem. So this is after it's been divided. After the kingdom's been divided, the northern tribes are functioning as their own country. And they make an alliance with Syria, a completely different country, to the northeast. They come together. They say, let's go attack Jerusalem. Okay, we're going to attack the southern kingdom, the two tribes. This is two nations against one. And the nation that they're going up against is not a very big nation, only two tribes. And Benjamin was the smallest of the tribes. So, I mean, this is a small group of people up against two much larger nations. And so when they heard this, okay, so the people who are in Jerusalem, the capital city of the south, when the king, okay, and he is a descendant of David, okay, David was his great, 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 however many generations before him, grandfather, as King Ahaz and his people heard that these other two armies were in league together and going to attack, they shook like the trees, it said. They were scared, and rightly so. This is a much bigger force coming up against them. The Lord said to Isaiah, go out to meet Ahaz, you and Shear-Jashub, your son, at the end of the conduit of the upper pool on the highway to the washer's field. And say to him, be careful, be quiet, do not fear, and do not let your heart be faint because of these two smoldering stumps of firebrands at the fierce anger of Rezin and Syria and the son of Remaliah. Because Syria with Ephraim and the son of Remaliah has devised evil against you, saying, let us go up against Judah and terrify it, and let us conquer it for ourselves and set up the son of Tabeel as king in the midst of it. So through this passage right here, through the prophet Isaiah, through what God is saying, we find out exactly what these two other nations were intending to do. They were intending to replace King Ahaz. They were putting a different king. They were going to conquer the nation, yes, but they were putting up a vassal king over Judah instead. Now, when you do this in the ancient world, it's not just like you vote him out, okay, and he's going to go live in his house for the rest of his life while this other king is ruling. No, that's not how you replace a king in the ancient world. You kill him, you kill his kids, you kill his family. That's how you replace a king. There's going to be no survivor left of this family because we're replacing him with this guy named Tabeel. Ahaz probably knows that this is their plan. Okay, it doesn't say that here. We don't know that for sure, but it's very likely that he understands, and this is part of the reason why he is scared as he sees this army coming up against him. He knows that they are there for him. He knows that he is about to be replaced, and him and his kids and his entire family is toast. Thus says the Lord God, it shall not stand, and it shall not come to pass, for the head of Syria is Damascus, and the head of Damascus is Rezin. Within 65 years, Ephraim will be broken to pieces so that it will no longer be a people. And the head of Ephraim is Samaria, and the head of Samaria is the son of Remelia. What God is basically saying here is, look, I decide who is king. I decide where the boundaries of these nations are. There is a nation of Syria. There is a capital city of Damascus. That is the capital of Syria. Damascus is the capital of Syria. And in charge of that is Rezin. That's what I've decided. And I've already given Pekah an authority. I've already given him a kingdom, and that is Ephraim. That is the northern tribes. That's where he's in charge. In a way, he's saying, you know what? I've decided that you're in charge of Judah. You are the king here. I decide that. Nobody replaces you unless I say so. And God has already made a promise to this family that there is going to be a descendant of David ruling upon the throne. His line is not going to be cut off. That is an unconditional covenant that he made to his forefather David. So we see that as Ahaz's world is falling apart around him, would you say that he felt like his world was falling apart? I mean, he's holed up in his city. He may be looking over the walls. I heard somebody preach this passage, and he said, I wonder if it felt like Helm's Deep. Anyone watch Lord of the Rings? And they're like standing up in there, and all the orcs are, you know, outside the gate. A couple of you liked that reference. But, yeah, this is a terrible situation. This is not a good day for Ahaz as he sees these much larger armies outside of Jerusalem. I bet you he felt like his world was falling apart. But God is a God who speaks to us. How do we hold it together? Here's the thing. God is a God who speaks to us, and that is radical. That is something absolutely crazy when you think about it. Who are we that God would take time out of his day to talk to us? Do you know that we wouldn't know anything about God unless he chose to reveal himself to us? There's no way that we could figure it out all by our own. It's not inside of us. It's not something that if we think long enough about who God is and what he is like, that we're just going to come to it and we're going to figure it out because we're so smart. That's not how it works. God is choosing to reveal himself to us. He's done that through his creation. We can look all around us every single day and just see how powerful he is to have made everything that is, and how it all works together. Man, I love watching nature documentaries because you just see all these things about how nature works and it just happens, and it's like, holy cow, that this has been meticulously planned. We can see all this stuff, but he's also revealed himself very specifically to us in his word. Very, very specifically. And he's given it to us, and we have it in our language, and we can read it, and it's incredible. God is a God who speaks to us. He's speaking to us right now. He's speaking to us today. He's speaking to us every single day if we will just listen. He spoke to Joseph. I bet that Joseph felt like his world was falling apart as he found out his betrothed was pregnant, and he knew it had nothing to do with him. But God spoke to him. God sent an angel, very specific to him. God speaking to Ahaz right here by sending him the prophet Isaiah. God is a God who speaks to us. The second point I want to make here this morning is God desires for us to respond in faith. What do we do when God speaks to us? God desires for us to respond in faith. Let's read the next verse there, or the same verse, Isaiah 7, 9. The end of this, what God is saying to Ahaz, if you are not firm in faith, you will not be firm at all. What is faith? What is faith? You know, faith is standing on the facts of God's word. Faith is taking God at his word and trusting in that, believing in it. What does Romans 10:17 tell us? Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. If God has not spoken, that's not biblical faith. Our faith has to be based on something that God has said, something that is true from his word, something that he's spoken to us. That is what we put our faith on. This quote here from an author I like named Miles Stanford says, "Unless our faith is established on the facts of the word of God, it is no more than conjecture, superstition, speculation, or presumption." When we were living in Paraguay, for those who don't know, my wife and my family, we were missionaries in Paraguay. And for the first few years that we were there, we didn't have a vehicle. So in the United States, like, we manufacture vehicles here, right? So there's a big used car market, and you can find something, you know, affordable. In Paraguay, everything is imported from Japan, and the used car market is ridiculously expensive. So for a couple years, we didn't have personal vehicle. We used public transportation. And one lady at the church we were attending in the capital city said, you know, "John, why don't you have a vehicle yet? Like, you guys are Americans. Like, why don't you have a vehicle?" I said, "Well, you know, they're expensive, and we're saving up to be able to buy one, hopefully." And she said, "I thought you were a man of faith," she said. "I thought you were a missionary, a man of faith. That's not how you do it, saving up. That's ridiculous. What you do is you go to the car lot, you find the one that you want, and you say, 'Este va a ser mío en el nombre del Señor.' This is going to be mine in God's name. You claim it," she said. "That's faith." And, man, can that be biblical faith? Absolutely not. God has not promised me a vehicle if I put my hand up and claim it in his name. I can't base my faith on something that he has not said. That is speculation. That is presumption. That is superstition. That is turning God into a magic spell. That is not how faith works. Faith is based on something that he has said. What has God said? "Everyone who believes in him will have eternal life." That is something that he has said, and that is something that I can put my faith on. He says that by believing on his son, I can have everlasting life. I can take that to the bank. Ahaz could take his promise to the bank. God had made an unconditional covenant with his great-great-grandfather David that there was going to be a continuation of his rulership forever. You know, and thinking about Joseph, going back to Matthew now, we're jumping around, but thinking back to Joseph, man, he responded in faith when God spoke to him, right? God spoke to him and said, "Don't be afraid to take Mary as your wife." Tells Joseph what is going on, explains it to him. And Joseph believes that. He believes that God is telling him the truth. And he responds in faith. He took Mary as his wife. He didn't just believe it up here. He actually did something. He said, "Okay, I believe you, God. I'm going to take Mary as my wife." He responded in faith, and that is what God desires from us. When he speaks to us, he desires that we respond in faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, Hebrews says. So, how does King Ahaz, respond to God speaking? Verse 10, again, the Lord spoke to Ahaz, "Ask a sign of the Lord your God. Let it be as deep as Sheol or high as heaven." But Ahaz said, "I will not ask. I will not put the Lord to the test." God said, "Go ahead. You know what? I've just made you a promise that it's not going to happen." Okay, so they're coming in. The armies are coming in. They want to replace you. That will not happen, is what God has just told him. It's not going to happen. Ask me a sign. I'll prove it to you. I'll just ask any sign you want, anything. It's up to you, Ahaz. What do you want me to do to prove to you that I'm going to do what I said I'm going to do? What do you want me to do to prove that I'm truthful, that I'm trustworthy, that I'm faithful? What do you want me to do? And Ahaz responds in false piety, says, I'm not going to ask anything. I'm not going to put God to the test. How ridiculous. God is offering it to him, and he responds by rejecting. No, I don't need a sign. The truth is, Ahaz didn't believe, so he didn't want a sign anyway. He didn't believe it to begin with. He didn't believe that God was going to do anything for him. So this is how God responds. And he said, "Hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary men that you weary my God also?" It's not enough that you're making everyone else's life miserable around you. You gotta bother me too. That's basically how he's responding. It's not enough that you weary men. You gotta weary God now. Come on. Therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Fine. You don't want to ask for something? You don't want to ask for a sign? Fine. I'll give you a sign. I'll give you one. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel, God with us. In the end, see, we know how this ends because of Matthew. Matthew points back to this and says, you know, Jesus is the fulfillment of this prophecy. Jesus is descended from David. See, this is how God could make this covenant with him years ago, how he could promise that there was always going to be a ruler from the house of David on the throne, because he was going to fulfill that himself. Descended from David, King Jesus, reigning forever. So really, what is God doing here with Ahaz, with this prophecy of Emmanuel? He's afraid that his line is going to be wiped out, Ahaz. He's afraid that he's going to be killed, his sons are going to be killed, and there's going to be no more descendants from the line of David. And God's saying, you know what? There's actually going to be a descendant from you. There's going to be a guy named Emmanuel, and he is going to reign forever. He's going to continue on. There's no way that your line is going to end, because I made an unconditional covenant with David. It's going to happen. I'm going to make sure of it. Ahaz does not respond in faith at all. He utterly rejects God's word here. He responds in unbelief. So besides Isaiah 7, we're not going to read it all, but you can write it down if you want to study it later. We read about King Ahaz in 2 Kings 16, and we read about him in 2 Chronicles 28. And each account is pretty different. It's not that they're contradictory, it's just that they talk about different parts of the story that are left out in the other passages. So when you read all three, you're kind of getting three different glimpses into what was going on back in Ahaz's time. But here's what we read. So basically, after these armies came up against Jerusalem, they weren't able to take it, obviously. That's what God said. They weren't able to conquer the city of Jerusalem. However, there were battles that took place between the southern kingdom, Judah, and the other two alliances. There were some battles that took place, and the southern kingdom lost big. Ahaz was not killed. His line continued on, but there were casualties from the southern kingdom. It says that 120,000 men of valor were killed in one day from the tribe of Judah. Those are big casualties on the southern kingdom's side. They took over some of the smaller cities around Jerusalem. And one of Ahaz's sons, Maaseiah, he was killed in battle. So one of his sons was actually killed in one of these battles. So after they defeated some of these smaller cities, northern Israel, the northern kingdom, Ephraim, Samaria, all those names refer to the same place, they took a bunch of people captive to their place, and they got there, and their elders were like, "You don't think that we have enough of our own problems that you're going to make God even more angry at us for bringing these captives? Send them back." So they send them back. Syria, on the other hand, they take a bunch of captives back to their capital city in the northeast, Samaria. Once that happens, Ahaz, what does he do? he calls out to the king of Assyria for help. Okay, so we've rejected God. We don't trust God. We don't trust what he has to say. We don't want a sign. We don't want anything. In fact, he takes treasures out of the temple that were there for a reason. They were there for the ceremonial purposes. He takes those treasures out of there as payment to the king, Tiglath-Pileser. They don't name him Kevin and stuff like that back then. He takes these things out of there as a payment, sends it off to Assyria. He says, hey, you're our father. Like rejecting God as our father, he says, hey, you are our father. Here's payment. We need your help. And so Assyria is like on the other side of Syria. So picture Syria in between Judah and Assyria. So as Assyria comes down, they conquer Syria in Damascus. And then Ahaz goes up and meets him in the capital city of Damascus. He goes up to meet with the king of Assyria. And while he is there, he sees all the religious things of Syria, their altars and how they worship their false idols. And Ahaz said, wow, they helped Damascus. They helped Syria. I wonder if they'll help us. So he makes a model of the Syrian altar, the Syrian worship practices. He makes a model, sends it back to the priests in Jerusalem, says, we need one of these. Can you make this exactly as they have it up there? Absolutely. And so they make these things. And for the rest of his life, he sacrificed on these false altars to false gods. It says that he worshiped under every green tree. This was part of the religious practices of the region, not part of worshiping the true God. He was an idolater for the rest of his life. Actually, for all of his life, even before this story as well. Completely rejecting the one true God. And here's the thing. God still spoke to him. God still reached down to speak to him, gave him opportunity to respond in faith. He did not. Really, the temptation is there for us as well, isn't it? As the world is falling apart around us, as your world is falling apart around you, through the circumstances that we've seen, the circumstances we're going to see, 2020 is not over yet, just saying. Things could get worse. And the temptation is there for us to not trust, to not respond in faith, to respond in self-sufficiency. You know, oftentimes God has spoken to us very clearly on a subject, and we want to believe God, and we want to trust him, but then something brilliant pops in our head, and we just have to go with that instead because we're just so smart, right? No, man, don't trust in your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. God is calling us to trust him, to respond in faith when he speaks. How do you hold it together? You listen to what God says and respond in faith. That implies that we're listening. God is speaking. God is active. He is a communicative God. He is always speaking, always reaching out, always revealing himself to us. Are we listening? It implies a need to be still and listen. It implies a need to be in the Word. Not casually. Not waiting for the Bible verse of the day to pop up on your news feed somewhere. No, actively engaging with His Word. Actively studying it, listening. When you don't understand what the passage is saying, praying and say, God, I need you to teach this to me. I do not understand. I need some help. That's part of, he wants that. He is the teacher. Man, and responding in faith. It is not enough just to listen. It is not enough just to hear his voice. We have to respond in faith. We have to respond in trust. We have to respond in belief. It's not perfect all the time. I think of the guy who talked to Jesus. I do believe, Lord. Help me with my unbelief. It's a process. He's growing us. He understands where we are, and we believe to this point, and now he's working to help us get to the next step of deepening our faith, strengthening our faith, growing in him. But we have to respond in faith. You know, Ahaz's son was King Hezekiah. Now, what's interesting, okay, because Ahaz rejected what God had to say, rejected God completely, trusting him in the situation, paid off the king of Syria, it actually wound up being a very bad thing for him, surprise. The king of Syria actually made life miserable for Ahaz the rest of his life. He had to pay tribute. It was not a good situation. It was not a help us one time and then we're done. No, the king of Assyria made life difficult for King Ahaz the rest of his life. When his son Hezekiah became king, Assyria is still causing problems for the southern kingdom, still causing problems for Judah. And they actually come up once again, the city surrounded, they're inside, holed up, and they're about to be attacked again. And it's so interesting. I wasn't going to read it, but I'm going to now. 2 Chronicles 32, 7 and 8. Listen to how King Hezekiah, and I just want you to hear his words here. I think it's so interesting. This is King Ahaz's son. Verse 7. So they're surrounded by this much bigger, much more powerful, and vicious. The Assyrians were vicious. It wasn't enough just to beat you. They had to humiliate you. They had to really tear you down on top of it. Here's what Hezekiah said to his people, outnumbered, outgunned. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or dismayed before the king of Assyria and all the horde that is with him, for there are more with us than with him. With him is an arm of flesh, but with us is the Lord our God. He's saying Emmanuel. He's saying God with us. This is the son of Ahaz. Ahaz says, I don't want to hear what you have to say. I don't need a sign. I don't believe anyway. Hezekiah, this is a response of faith. God is with us. Isn't that incredible? That is what God wants from us, as a response of faith. The third and final point I want to make this morning is God's gift to us is himself. God's gift to us is himself. God is with us. As we go through life, as we go through the circumstances, the hard times, the good times too, Paul says that we have to learn contentment in the good times as well as the bad times. It's a struggle in both. As we go through life, and it feels like the world is falling apart around us, and we're in this constant struggle, this constant battle to remember to listen to God and respond in faith. As we do this, God is with us in the midst. It's not a separate thing where he's far off and he's given us instructions for how this is going to work while we're on our own. We're not in the boat while the storm is raging around us and we're all alone. No, Jesus is in the boat with us. Just like the disciples. You remember that story? Master, don't you care if we drowned? And Jesus is sitting right there in the boat with them. That's how it is. Emmanuel, that's the promise. God is with us. You know, to the believer in Christ, this is what I say. Matthew 28:20 says, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. That is the promise from God to us as believers. God is with us. Yes, things do get out of control. Yes, things do look like they're falling apart around us. Absolutely. And yes, there is a battle going on inside of us to respond in faith. We constantly want to resort back to self-sufficiency, the self-life, that we have it all figured out, that we can do it on our own. We constantly wish to revert to that. But while we are going through it, God is right there with us. He has not left us. He hasn't forgotten about us. That's hard to remember when we get down to it, when a practical brass tacks level. That is very hard to remember, but it is a promise nonetheless. And that's another thing that God has said, that we have to respond in faith when God doesn't feel like he's in the boat with us, when we don't feel like our prayers get any higher than this, responding in faith and saying, you know what, I actually hear you, God, what you're saying, that I am with you always. I hear that. I'm listening, and I'm going to respond in faith, even though I don't feel like you're here with me, even though I do not feel like you've got this under control. I feel like you've somehow lost, you've got the edges of the universe under control, but right here in my life, somehow something came undone. Even when we feel that way, choosing instead to respond in faith and say, you know what, God has said, I am with you always, and I'm going to believe that. He's right here with me. To the unbeliever, you know what? It's slightly different. So if you have not believed in Jesus Christ, if you have not trusted him, if somehow you're still relying on yourself to gain favor with him, we all know that we're sinners, right? We know that. We recognize our sinfulness before God. That's not going to be remedied on your own. That's not going to be fixed. You can't come up with a plan that's going to bridge that gap. It's only through his son. His son did it for you. He's paid the price. It's over and done at the cross. And as we accept that, as we believe in him, as we place our faith and say, there is no course for me to be reconciled to God except through Jesus Christ, and I'm going to trust that that is enough. Until we've done that, man, we're still in our sins. Until we have rested fully on Christ and what he's done for us. But here's what God says to you. In Acts 17, 27 and 28, Paul is talking to a group of unbelievers, and he says, he is actually not far from each of us. Is the world falling apart around you and you're not a believer? You know what? He's not far from you. He is not far at all. Paul will go on to say, in him we live and move. In him we have our being. He is all around us. We have to open our eyes to him. You realize the very breath that we take right now, that right there, that was because God gave it to you, and you're alive for 1 second longer. In him we live and move. In him we live. Your very life right now, you are still alive because God wants it to be. We move, we have our being. He is not far from any of us. You know, sometimes we feel like God is far, though, don't we? We feel like he's far away. We don't feel like we actually deserve him to be close. That's probably true. We don't deserve, but fortunately, it does not rest on us. God is a giver. He is always reaching out to us. You know, this guy Ahaz, I mean, God went out of his way for him, didn't he? When you think about it, he didn't have to send Isaiah. He didn't have to explain anything. Could have just left. I mean, he knew he wasn't going to respond in faith anyway, so why bother, right? God went out of his way for Ahaz. It's an act of love. That's an act of mercy. That's an act of kindness. That is an act of a God who cares. But Ahaz was a bad dude. He was a bad dude. And the historical context of who Ahaz was, I've been saving this. The Bible says that he sacrificed his kids to Moloch. Have you heard of who Moloch was? This is grotesque, the idol worship of Moloch. He was a statue of a bull made with some sort of metal, brass I believe it was, and there was kind of a hollow on the inside of this idol. And they could make a fire inside of it, and it would heat the metal up. And once it got glowing red hot, the bull has his hands out like this. They would set the babies on it and burn them to death in that way. The priest would bang the drums so that the parents couldn't hear the screaming child. That is how grotesque the Bible says he sacrificed sons, plural. We don't know how many he actually sacrificed to idols. But this is who King Ahaz was. So I ask, is there anything that we have done that's going to completely separate us from the opportunity to know God, to respond to him? He's still reaching out. This guy, Ahaz, didn't deserve it at all. But you know what? We don't deserve it either. We absolutely do not. We don't deserve anything from God. It is all a gift. It is all grace. Because that is who God is. He is a gracious God. When we mess up as believers, we can confess our sins, and he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. As unbelievers, man, do you know that your sin has already been, all of us, but unbelievers as well, all of our sins have already been paid for. That's already been a past transaction. God has already made a way through his son, Jesus Christ. Gave his only son so that we do not have to die. He allowed his son to be killed on our behalf, even though his son was completely innocent and we were completely guilty. The innocent for the guilty. The righteous for the unrighteous. He became sin who knew no sin so that we could become the righteousness of God. That is a completely unfair transaction, but extremely merciful. It's an opportunity. It is what the story of Emmanuel is all about. That God is with us. He has not forsaken us. He hasn't left us. It's who he is. You know, it wasn't actually his name, right? That wasn't actually Jesus' name. You will call his name Jesus, but he was called Emmanuel. So it's more of an attribute. It's more recognition of who he is as a person, not his actual name on his birth certificate. And I think that's illustrative, that it is part of his character that he is with us. And that's the story of Emmanuel. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for your son. God, that's what Christmas is all about, is him. And we recognize that. We thank you that you are with us indeed, that you have given your son, that you've never left us while the world's falling apart around us, and that for those of us who do not know you, that you're not far. You're right here. You're waiting to be heard. You're waiting to have us respond in faith. God, we thank you for everything you've given us, and we're going to trust you, Father, moving forward. We're going to trust you in what's going on around the world. We're going to be faithful to what you have said, despite everything going on around us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Lord, I come, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is born. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. God, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, how I need you.
Sorry, I was ministering afar. Have a seat. It's amazing what happens when you run out to your office to get your microphone and put your stuff down, then you have opportunity to minister to folks. Gosh, John, where'd you go, John? John? Is he right in front of me? Ah, there you are. It's like, I was afraid to, I didn't see you. Great message. Thank you, John. A little bit of trivia. You may not know that John's parents' daughter is his sister. Right? So Becky is John's sister, so that's pretty exciting. If you did not know that, I had heard that earlier. Hey, lots of stuff, and if you liked that message from John Q. Public, then come out to Men to Men if you are a man to man. And John leads our Men to Men group on Monday nights. And we also have our women's group that also meets on Monday night. Come out for that and enjoy fellowship with one another around the Word of God. It's a good time to rub elbows with fellow believers. And gosh, if we would do that a little bit more often, I think that a lot of the discouragement that we might feel would kind of be pushed to the side and gain encouragement and strength from one another through the blood of Jesus. Bible study tonight is back to the regularly scheduled time of 5:30. Our students meet at 5 o'clock. And on Wednesday, it's very appropriate. Wednesday, Awana is on Veterans Day, and it is patriotic theme night. So that's exciting, Wednesday night. Then next Saturday, for all you men that are hungry, I mean, I hope you don't wait until next Saturday, but if you don't have any food between now and then, as men's breakfast is on Saturday morning at 8 o'clock. So please come out for that. If you have any issues, please call Zane. He's on call all week long, and he loves to answer his phone, particularly in the middle of the night. He doesn't get it until the next morning, but, you know, call him at night, and he'll get it when he gets around to it. Let's stand and be dismissed. I hope I didn't. Whoa, I got people waving and hollering. Oh, there's a cook-off for chili. When?
It's next Sunday. The youth are doing a chili cook-off, so we need people to make chili. We need people to eat chili, and we have, yeah, it's for our students.
So chili cook-off, if you have questions about chili cook-off, what that's all about, please see Becky or Sean or Ivy, and they'll give you all the deets about that. Zane, you waved at me. Or are you just saying yo? Say that in English slower. Let me translate. Operation Christmas Child Boxes are due next Sunday. For those of you who listen really fast, Operation Christmas Child Boxes are due next Sunday. So that's with the time change too, right? That was last week. All right. Gare.
This is Gary Wirtz.
Oh, you just want me to stay? I thought maybe you just, you know. I'm in trouble now, buddy. Man.
October was Pastor Appreciation Month. And so I know it's November. You're a little slow. But yeah, sorry. I'm going to turn over and introduce our actor and I'll take one there.
Great job.
Share that mic and I'm going to leave one or run into one.
I always like to.
Is this on?
Yes.
I have to see one of these.
Candy.
I had to do it.
point. This has been the longest 7 years of my life this year. Our intention is to get a revision to the Constitution and bylaws out in plenty of time for you to review and look at. We've made a number of changes in the last months, and our pastors have looked at it and cross-checked and just done the best we could to make sure we have a good document given what happened last year to make sure that we have a good. It ain't going to be as good as the Constitution, but it's going to be good. We've looked at it, but I want to get that out to our members so that you have enough time that you can look at it. There are changes so that you will know what's changed and compare to the other one, to our original one. Call this Revision 1, as well as putting out that's our Constitution bylaws. We also have to have articles of incorporation that we formally vote on, as we are now and officially recognized by the IRS 501c3. We were recognized in Georgia, but I filed the paperwork earlier this year to get that official, also as a result of what happened to us last year. It affords us some other protection. So our goal is for the Constitution, bylaw, and revision, our articles of incorporation, and our budget to all be voted on December the 20th so that we can, so that budget can keep rolling for 2021. Not a lot of changes in the budget, but there are some significant changes in our Constitution. So I thank for our pastors that have looked over that to help me, because I missed stuff, and appreciate their diligence in that document. Brucey?
So if October is Pastor Appreciation Month, why are we doing this in November? Because everybody knows that November is chock full of opportunities to offer thanks, honor, and appreciation for those who have helped us, protected us, and sown so much into our lives. Thanksgiving Day, the one day out of the year that we thank Native Americans for teaching us how to plant corn, make deer stew, and y'all know those little aluminum jackets that you put on the end of the turkey wings to keep them from burning? I don't know if they come up with that, but whoever did, I appreciate that. You know what I mean? Veterans Day, the one day of the year that we show honor and appreciation to all those who have served in our country in the military. Are we having a parade this year?
Okay. There's no public activities ever again.
Okay. I didn't think so. But and Edicimad, who doesn't know that? Edicimad. You know, it took me the longest time to figure out what that was. Now I know. Every day in Camden County is Military Appreciation Day. I never knew. Until recently. And this, Pastor Appreciation Day. The one day of the year, one day, that church folks are required, okay, are required to tell their pastors, clergy, bishops, maybe even the Pope how good of a job that they've done during the year. And probably not the Pope this year, because I think he may have said some things that were, what, taken out of context, and he's... And I'm sure you guys have never said anything, or you haven't said anything this year that's been taken out of context. No, okay. So we'll show our appreciation for y'all based on that fact alone. Seriously. As a church, and more importantly as individuals, I hope we haven't used opportunities, required opportunities, to express to you guys our appreciation for what you do. The thanks for your commitment to this ministry. Things that we should be doing daily, not just in word, you know, in deed. I hope we have not let the year go by without telling you guys that we love you. We need you. We appreciate you. We're thankful for you. I got a letter here from one of our members here at 3RC. And the handwriting looks pretty familiar. It may be mine, but I'm going to read it anyway. Because he is a member of this church. So I think it was Paul that said in one of his letters to Peter, Therefore, I exhort the elders among you as your fellow elder and witness of the sufferings of Christ, as a partaker also of the glory that is to be revealed, shepherd the flock of God among you, exercising oversight, not compulsion, but voluntarily, according to the will of God, and not for sordid gain, but with eagerness, not yet as lording it over those allotted to your charge, but proving to be an example to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you receive the unfading crown of glory. He's our shepherd. We're the sheep of his flock. We hear his voice and we follow him. You're his under shepherds, and we're the sheep of your flock. We hear your voice and we follow you. Why? Because you follow him. We trust you. You've proven yourselves. It's been a bad year. I say bad. There's been some good stuff in this year, but it's been a terrible year in a lot of ways. A lot of ways. But how have you proven yourself? When wolves crept in from within and without, you didn't run as a hireling to protect yourself. You defended and protected us, your sheep. When disease and death lay at your family's doors, seeking to steal your faith and your hope, your loved ones' lives, you didn't give up. You ministered to us physically through the word, and you gave us faith, hope, and life. So today, on this one day, collectively as a group, we want to say that we need you. We love you. We appreciate you. We thank you for staying true to your individual calls, for fighting the good fight, for loving us when we, like smelly old straying sheep at times. You loved us anyway. You left those that didn't need you at the time to bring those of us back that did. We're better followers of Christ because of you. We want to thank you for that. Some of us at 3RC participated in an offering that was taken up, and we'd like to give that to you. And remember, you know, what I said earlier about you will one day receive the unfading crown of glory, because this is going to pale in comparison to that. I'm telling you that right now. More importantly, we'd like to pray for you guys, your families, your ministries, each of you individually. So that if you would take the opportunity to bring these guys before the
honor. Thank you, guys. I just want to say, just reiterate, we appreciate you guys. We really do. We thank you for your courage. We thank you for your weekly sacrifice. We thank you that you are dependable. We really appreciate you guys. And just speak it on behalf. We love you guys. And thank you. And I thought about a scripture, Psalms 37:23. The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in all of his ways. So I pray that you trust in the Lord, and you lean not to your own understanding, but in all your ways acknowledge God, and he shall direct your path. I pray that God's wisdom governs your heart as you govern his people. And I pray the favor of God reigns on your family and your children. We pray for God's protection of your families. We pray for God's provision for your families. We pray for your children. If any parent in here knows, that's our pride and our joy, our kids. And we pray that Satan will take his hands off our kids. We possess and hold the power, and we rebuke the work of Satan. And we declare our children to God that the world doesn't get them. God, this is a promise. And we are declaring it, and we are standing together. Where there's two or three gathered in your name, God, you're in the midst of us, God. And we declare that Satan does not have our children. He desires to destroy our kids. And God, we just want you, and we're coming to you, and we're calling on you, God, to deliver our kids from the hands of the enemy. Bring them back, God, and worship. Our kids know the truth, that they will be brought back to that truth, and that they will bring glory and honor to you, God. Father, there's nothing too hard for you. With man, we are limited. We have limited resources, Father. But God, you are unlimited, God. And Father, we pray, God. We just want to just stand in agreement, God, and just plead the blood of Jesus on our kids. All of our kids. Anyone that's represented in here, God. Our children are our pride and our joys. And God, this world chooses for them to go another way, God. But God, we want to stand in the gap, and we want to intercede on behalf of our children, God, that you will deliver them, God, from the world, God, from the entanglement of the world, that you will untangle that wiring, God, that's on their hearts and on their minds, those strongholds, God. We declare victory, God, in our children's lives. And that's what we declare, God, for our pastors as well, God, that are head